It's good to be with you this morning. Hopefully our introit has given you a little inkling that today we are in our worship as well as everything else, just paying attention to and remembering and celebrating the fact that this week has been Christian Aid Week. And hopefully you've had your envelope through the door and been able to pop a little something in there. If you haven't managed to and you'd like to, Jean Dobber is our organist is here and she will happily help you to give some money to Christian Aid if you would like to. I thank you also to everybody who came to our vision morning yesterday at Lower Hards Village Hall. There was a goodly number of us and we had a lively morning talking and reflecting. But the upshot is, we're doing really well, and so we should all be very pleased with how things are. There'll be some notes from that for everybody to see when we get them sorted out, so you can look forward to reading a bit more about that. Our first hymn this morning is number 6 in your hymn books, and we're going to omit verses 5 and 6.
Oh,
sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God,
our heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria, Gloria, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Gloria,
thank you.
Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem by the sheep gate there is a pool called in Hebrew Beth Zaphar, which has five porticos. In these lay many invalids, blind, lame and paralyzed. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he'd been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, and while I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was the Sabbath. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Amen.
Please do. Jews would gather to pray because they had all their ritual hand washing to do
So they need to be by the water. And what do they find? I love this. I think this is such a delicious irony given some of the things that Paul says in some of his letters. There is no man from Macedonia there. Instead, the apostles find a group of women gathered by the river to pray. So what do they do, Paul and his companions? What's their big move in advancing the gospel? What is the mission and ministry strategy here? Drum roll. They sit down and talk to the women. That's it. And as much as I struggle with the apostle Paul from time to time, I must concede that he is on to something here. When I think about what it is that I do in the parish from week to week, quite a lot of it actually involves sitting down and talking to women. At Little Lambs, at the parents' prayer meeting, at Mansfield Court, over a cuppa, there is a lot of sitting down and talking to women in parish ministry. Now, disclaimer here, I am not restricted to only talking to women. I'm quite happy to talk to anybody else who would like to sit down and talk to me as well. But on this occasion, the first century mission and ministry team sit down and talk to the women. And they meet Lydia. Lydia is a worshipper of God. And that means that she is a Gentile convert to Judaism. She's decided to become a Jew. She already believes in God and she is there to worship at the river. She's from Thyatira, which means she's not from around here. She's a dealer in purple cloth, which means she's a businesswoman of independent means. And Lydia listens eagerly. She is a woman ready and waiting, hungry for the gospel, ready to receive the good news. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. She and her household are baptized, and then she responds to the gospel message with generosity and hospitality, inviting the apostles to stay at her home. And a bunch of other stuff happens in Philippi, which isn't in our reading today. But by the end of the chapter, by the time Paul and co are politely asked to leave the city of Philippi, there's a church in Philippi, and it's at Lydia's house. Paul had a vision of a man from Macedonia saying, "Come and help us." He and his companions sat down and talked. Lydia, hungry for the word of God, responded with hospitality and generosity. She, as an independent businesswoman, had the means and the wherewithal to start a church in her home. So that's the Bible bit. Now, in this day and age, we don't need visions in the night to become aware of people far away from us who might be saying, "Come and help us." We see them all the time on our TV screens. And this week, we've had the Christian Aid envelope through our doors. Talk about people in a faraway place saying, "Come and help us." The focus for Christian Aid Week this week is women in rural Zimbabwe who rely on farming for their food and their income. Because because of drought, this is a daily struggle, and it's made worse by the climate crisis and by the effects of war in the Ukraine on global food production. They might very well help us. And of course, we can't all get up immediately and go to faraway places like Paul did. And quite honestly, I'm not sure how much help we would be if we did all get up and go. But when we spend time engaging with the lived experience of communities like those women in Zimbabwe, and we choose to give and act and pray this Christian Aid Week, we respond to a similar situation, a similar invitation, not by going in person, as Paul did, but in our partnership with the organisations that are already there who can work on the ground to make a difference. And while we can't physically sit down and talk with the women of Zimbabwe, we can spend time listening to some of their stories that have been shared. And if you've had the envelope, there's a woman called Jessica on the front there. She's a mum. She's the only breadwinner in her family. She's trying to run a farm, and she's at the mercy of climate change. And so while Lydia was hungry for the gospel, Jessica is just hungry. Full stop. When we listen to Jessica, she says, "My children crave a decent meal, but I can't provide. It pains me to send them to bed hungry." And when we engage with Jessica's story, it's we ourselves who are invited to respond with generosity and hospitality, as so many of you have already done this week, with soup lunches, with giving what you can, with dropping off envelopes and collecting them all up. We are all invited to help to turn hunger into hope. So we don't need a vision in the night to hear the women of Zimbabwe saying, "Come and help." When we sit down and listen to their stories, we hear about Jessica, who is hungry and eager to feed her family. And we're invited, as many of us have already done, to respond with hospitality and generosity. And I could leave it there, but I think that there's something else as well that we can take away here from this first century mission and ministry strategy, about how we might approach this thing the Church of England calls mission and ministry in our own contexts. It was wonderful to hear about the things that are going really well in our parish yesterday. It was great to share those and to celebrate them. And I think it's also fair to say that, from what I heard, there's pretty much an open invitation to everyone to come and help with what we're doing in our churches. Would that be a fair comment? And I wonder if we can learn something from Paul's example here. He went to where the people were gathered, and he sat down and talked to them. Now, of course, we need all the structural stuff. We need people to do all the things. And we have wonderful people in our church communities doing all sorts of things. Come and help us if you are a doer and you want to get involved in doing all sorts of things. But what I like about this particular approach right here is that anyone can do it. Anyone can and sit down and talk. We can all talk about what the church has meant to us. We can all talk about the faith that sustains us. We can all talk about the warmth and the kindness of people that we encounter in the church community. And we can all talk about our hopes for the future of our churches. And who knows, when we sit down and talk about it, we might find that, like Lydia, there are already people there. People who are ready and waiting. People who are hungry to hear the gospel, to receive it, and who, like Lydia, have the wherewithal to respond eagerly with generosity and hospitality so that the church can continue to grow and flourish.
We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
To live, for life itself, for our lives, and for this world. Grant us the grace to respect our beautiful world. We pray for the church within our parish and throughout the world, asking that wherever your people meet, there may be a real fellowship in which there are no quarrels and divisions, no distinctions of race, colour, of social standing, a fellowship in which all are truly one. We ask your blessing on those who serve you within our parish in any way, and on all who come to worship you in this place of prayer. Help us all to work and pray to make our churches a place where all feel truly welcome. Lord, in your mercy, we give thanks for Christian Aid and its work throughout the world as it challenges poverty, injustice, inequality, and world climate change. We pray for those who do not have access to clean water and sanitation, those without good health care, and the many families who are struggling to find food. May God grant them hope and surround them with signs of love and care. And we give thanks to the volunteers who work tirelessly in aid of Christian Aid. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
Heavenly Father, our hearts are troubled as we pray for all who continue to suffer due to the pandemic. We pray for those who are affected by particularly those more vulnerable in poorer countries. Let us pray. pray together, put an end to the war in Ukraine. Grant world leaders the courage, compassion and wisdom as they face challenging circumstances and decision making. We pray that this war does not escalate further. We give thanks to those who have opened their homes to the families who fled Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy, we particularly remember those in hospital and in care homes. We pray for everyone who is sick or anxious for themselves or their loved ones. For those who are bereaved and grieving or isolated. And we also pray for those who support them. God be their healer, their comforter, and their protector. Let us pause for a few moments as we pray for those known to us who now share with you the joys of your eternal kingdom. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ.
The Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, who will bear my light to them, whom shall I spare?
will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save.
Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you will lead me.
Lord, in heaven, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
this bread to share in the body of Christ. God, our Father, whose Son Jesus Christ gives the water of eternal life, may we thirst for you, the spring of life and source of goodness, through him who is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. We pray together. Father,
we give you thanks and praise that when we were so far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Thank you.
Some people here to celebrate the Ascension.